You know, when you left East Fork Consolidated High School or East Fork Baptist Church, you had to go through a little swamp. And in that swamp, the older people had told us that there was a man down that didn't have no hate. Ooh, so anytime we was walking through there, I'm talking about when I turned that curve in the road, my vest pocket would dip up sand when I come round through there. Me and my brother Sonny was playing baseball down in a pasture, and we let dark slip up on us. We had to go across that bridge down there where that headless man was. We was on a horse named Toxie. Sonny didn't have on no hat, but I had on an old baseball cap. He said, "Man, get ready. I'm fixing to hit that bridge running wide open where that headless man can't get us." Well, I turned my cap around, put it on real good where it wouldn't blow off, and I helped around Sonny's waist. And he said, "Come on, boogity, 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 here we went." And just as we got to that bridge, he took that line and said, "Ha!" And she made a lunge forward, and it throwed my head back, and the bill of that cap stuck me between the shoulder blades. "Ha! Sonny, he's got me! Woo! Hurry, hurry! He's got me, he's got me!" And we run up in the front yard, and I'm screaming. "Ah!" My mama come running out, and I said, "The headless man grabbed me back of my neck." My mama said, "Son, you know mama don't believe that." I said, "Mama, he grabbed me right back him, and I put my head back in the bill of that cap, stuck me." And if that hadn't happened right there in front of my mama and my brother, I would have died thinking that thing did have me. I do a weekly radio show called Country Crossroads, and a buddy of mine, what's the producer of that show, is named Jim Roop, and he's also a good pilot. The other day he called and said, "Jerry, I'm on my way to Nashville. Why don't I just stop in Yazoo City, Mississippi, and pick you up, and you can do the Grand Ole Opry, and I'll drop you off on my way back to Dallas early Sunday morning." I said, "Man, fine. I can go to church and Sunday school with my family." You know, I got to thinking, I said, "This will be an excellent weekend to take my preacher to see the Grand Ole Opry." Oh, I went out to the church and I said, "I want you to fly up to Nashville with me. I'll have you back in plenty of time to preach Sunday morning." He said, "Jerry, I ain't flying in no airplane." I said, "Brother Yates, you mean to tell me that I set out in the congregation and you get up and preach about if God be for you, who can be against you? And you quote from the book of Ephesians, 'Give thanks for all things,' and you talk about faith, and you scared to fly in an airplane? I'm ashamed of you." And Brother Yates said, "Jerry, the Bible says, 'Lo, I am with you always.'" Me and Marcel had been hunting all the morning. One morning, we had just got our discharge from the Navy. Money was a little more plentiful, but we didn't have too much of it. We stopped by the country store, and we just had a dime between us. Marcel told the storekeeper, Mr. Duval Scott, said, "I want a nickel's worth of soda crackers and a nickel's worth of cheese." He said, "We don't sell no 5 cents worth of cheese. We don't sell nothing under a dime's worth." Marcel said, "Well, I'll take a dime's worth then." And he whacked. to the Mississippi Gulf Coast. He was in his 80s, and we always wanted him to fulfill this great ambition. And Uncle Versy got out of the car. We stood listening as he walked across the sand and stood at the edge of the Gulf of Mexico and looked all out across the ocean. As far as he could see was nothing but water. And he stood there and looked, and we couldn't hardly get our breath. And Marcel said, "Papa, what do you think about it?" He said, "I always thought it'd have been bigger than this." Uncle Versy had a younger brother named Jake Ledbetter. And Jake Ledbetter was a little lazy. I'm talking about showing up. And he applied for welfare at the Amite County Courthouse due to blindness. And he got his youngest boy to take him down there in an old A-model car. And they held his hand while he made his ex as a blind man after the lady in the office filled out the form. About 3 days, he got word. They sent a rider out there and told him he had been turned down. Well, he wasn't satisfied. Got his boy to take him back. He said, "Mr. Jake Ledbetter, all you can do, Mr. Jake Ledbetter, is to go to Jackson, Mississippi, to the state capitol and appeal our decision." Well, he did that. He got him a ride to Jackson, Mississippi, and went to the state health department. And three fine doctors examined his eyes and told him that they'd have a decision for him in about 2 hours. They had to review tests and things. Well, while he was waiting for their decision, he walked down Capitol Street and read the menu in front of the big picture show there. Decided he'd go in and see the picture show. He went in and sat down, but one of them doctors had been assigned to follow Jake Ledbetter. And he eased in the picture show and sat down by him. And directly, Jake Ledbetter saw the doctor out of the corner of his eye, and he reached up and got him by the arm. He said, "Sir, would you be kind enough to tell me if this bus stops in Osaka?" Everybody always asks me why Uncle Versy Ledbetter and his wife got along so well. They never had an argument. On their 50th wedding anniversary, they both testified they had never had no problems. Now, I heard a story about them back when Uncle Versy married Aunt Pet Ledbetter. He took the mule and the buggy and picked her up and carried her off to the church and married her. And as they were driving in the mule and the buggy, going to their little shack to start their new home, Uncle Versy was sitting in the buggy and had his arm up on the back of the buggy, and he was saying sweet things to Aunt Pet. And about that time, the mule stumbled. And Uncle Versy said, "That's number one." And then he turned and would talk to Aunt Pet again. And in that little bit, the mule stumbled again. He said, "That's number two." And he turned and he talked to Aunt Pet. And in a little bit, the mule stumbled again and like to fail. He said, "All right, whoa, that's number three." He got his pistol, put it up to the mule's head, boom, and killed him dead. Aunt Pet said, "Versy, what in the world's wrong with you?" He said, "That's number one." I rode a school bus that didn't have no windows in it. Had a canvas that they rolled up and down. There are other lands that I could have been birthed in, and I would have been born into a certain class before I would have even had the opportunity to participate in show business. But not in America. If you got the backbone and the determination and you want to get it on, you can get it on. Ain't that wonderful? Listen to this. The house I live in, the friends that I have found, the folks beyond the railroad, and the people all around. The worker and the farmer, the sailor on the sea, the folks what built this country, that's America to me. The house I live in, my neighbors, white and black, the people who just come here are from generations back. The town hall and the soapbox, the torch of liberty, a home for all God's children, that's America to me. What about the words of old Abe Lincoln, of Jefferson and Payne, of Washington and Jackson, and the task that still remain? The little bridge at Concord, where freedom's fight began, our Gettysburg and Midway, and the story of Bataan. The house I live in, the goodness everywhere, a land of wealth and beauty with enough for all to share. A house that we call freedom, the home of liberty, and a promise for tomorrow. Oh, praise God, that's America to me.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marcel Ledbetter's favorite friend, Uncle Versy's favorite nephew, and Mississippi's favorite son, Jerry Clower.
Good gracious alive. Woo! I some kind of something another love ever one of you. I don't know of any place I had rather be than right here. And for me to do a show at Mississippi State University is just like throwing a rabbit in a briar patch. Because I have been here before. I have. I played football at Mississippi State University back in... Yeah. And I remember back in the spring of 49, we had 13 weeks of spring training. There was a lot of walk-ons, and every Saturday at the big scrimmage, we did the best we could to hold our position because there's so many walking on going out for football. I was afraid they may break my plate and give it to one of them. So I was putting out all I could, and one day a fella walked up. His name was Titus Plumeritis, and he was from up in New England. And that was the runnin'est thing I have ever seen in all my life. He would reverse the field sometimes just to show us how he could run through us, just getting it. Oh! And they pitched the ball to him one time on a quick pitch, and I was playing left defensive tackle. And I busted through and got him around the waist and commenced to squeezing him and was going to take him down to the ground. And about that time he wiggled and went straight up in the air, come down in my back and stomped. You country folks, now you know I have a sign what hangs in my office. It says there is no limit to what can be done if it doesn't matter who gets the credit. And I believe that. I used to go on pioneer missions, take a week of my vacation and give a preacher friend a week's vista out in Montana and other places. And I used to write down in my Bible about what a good job I was doing. One day I ripped all that out of my Bible and threw it in the fire. My wife said, "Darling, what in the world are you doing?" I said, "Honey, I am afraid when I get to heaven, the Lord won't have as much on his record as I got on mine." Did you country folks read in the paper the other day where the professor was presented with a plaque and a testimonial dinner because due to his research, he has actually discovered that the sun, the solar system, can be used to heat water? Did y'all read that? And 35 years ago, I drawed up a bucket of water and poured it in a number 3 wash tub. And on a Saturday afternoon, set the tub out in the sunshine. And that night, squatted in it and bathed myself. Yeah! While I was in a large northern city doing the theater in the round, I was in a big suite on the 9th floor, and on the bottom floor of my hotel was a mercantile store. I was there 9 nights, and 3 nights thieves robbed that mercantile store. And the thieves were stealing a wearing apparel that the young people have started wearing in the north. And this garment is so scarce. If you can steal you a few pair and put them on the black market, you can get rich overnight. Do y'all know what them thieves were stealing? Overhauls! Think of that! Woo! And it took me 20 years to get out of overhauls. I remember the first pair of khaki breeches I ever owned. Woo! Mama ordered them from Sears and Roebuck. I waited for the mail rider to bring them. I was so proud. I was going to get me some new khaki breeches. Mail rider drove up in that A model. I was sitting on the bank of a dirt road, handed that brown package out to me, and I busted it open and squatted over it. Ah! Now they were. And I just pulled my overhauls off and throwed them down in the middle of the dirt road. That's all I had on. Mama wouldn't let us wear underclothes with overhauls because it'd fade on them. And if you got you a brand new pair of them blue denim overhauls in the middle of the summertime, they'd blew you up pretty good too. They would. I grabbed my new khaki breeches out and commenced to putting them on. Oh, had them buttons on the front. Had a tag on that belt loop right there. I never did take it off. It said, "Tough Nut." One day, Uncle Versie Ledbetter and all of the school bus drivers were sitting around in the back of Mr. Duval Scott's store. And they were discussing various things, politics, brands of snuff, and other interesting views. One of the school bus drivers said, "Uncle Versie, your boy, Clovis,
He's done went off to college, been gone 2 years, never did come home. And I'm trying to make a decision whether that college education is worth it or not. Said, have you noticed anything different about Clovis? He's been home a month. Uncle Percy said, I ain't noticed nothing different. Said, you mean to tell me you spent 2 years a college cost on Clovis and he ain't changed a bit? Said, he's bound to walk different or talk different or something. He said, well, he was a good plow hand before he went off to school. And he plowed a mule named Beck. And I do notice occasionally he talks different. Before he went off to that college, he'd get out to the end of the row and he'd say, whoa, Beck, gee back and come up. Went to college 2 years and come back and was plowing the other day and I heard him say, halt, Rebecca. Pivot and proceed. Ooh, some of them tales at the old country store and things that we did, how wonderful it was. I'm telling you. We were in Sunday school one morning. Me and Marcel Ledbetter, we never missed Sunday school. And the teacher was quizzing us. And the teacher asked Marcel, said, Marcel, what was the occupation of the wise men? He said, they were firemen. Said, why in the world would you say that? He said, because the Bible plainly says they come from afar. Uncle Percy's mule Della was blind the last 5 years of her life. And over on Uncle Percy Ledbetter's farm, you could dig a dug well and hit water pretty shallow, like 25 to 30 feet. Over on the farm I lived on, you had to take an auger and put a big stick in the top of that thing, and a man put his chest up there and walk around with it, and another fella get opposite him and just round and around and dig a well, a deep one, that you put a well curbing in and a slender bucket. But over on Uncle Percy's farm, they just had a dug well, and I swapped work with them. I'd go work a day for them, and they'd come work a day for me, and I helped them dig the dug well. And after you start digging it, when you get down so far that you can't throw the dirt out of the hole, you have to put a fella down in the well with a bucket, fill the bucket up with dirt, tie a rope on it, and then you shimmy it up and dump it. Well, me and Ardell and Burnell was up on the top. And you, Dale, is down in there digging. We is working and Ardell hollered down to Udale, Udale, what? So we going to get a drink of water. All right. We went back out to the barn and took the bell off of old Della. Della was blind and we had to keep a bell on her because she'd get lost and we'd have to find her. And we had shut her up in the barn. And we ease back up to the top of that well. Udale is down in there. And we'd ring that bell. Ding, ling, 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 ling. And Udale said, whoa, Della. Whoa. Ding, ling, 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 ling. Back up back, Della. Back up back. Whoa, back. I don't know of nothing more frustrating than the thought of thinking an 1,100-pound blind mule is going to come down on your head foremost. We were sitting around a country store one day, and it was bird hunting time. Marcel Ledbetter come walking in. One of the men said, Marcel, where you been? Said, been quail hunting. Said, I killed a bunch of them, too. You did? Said, yeah. Marcel said, man, I killed 6 quail at one shot. Fella said, I bet you. Shot them sitting on the ground. Marcel said, can they fly? Let me tell you a true story. A lady had a little pet squirrel. She loved the little squirrel. Neighbors would come and watch the little squirrel bust the pecan hulls with its little mouth. And they thought it was cute. One day she was in the supermarket and she saw some beautiful pecans already hulled in a beautiful cellophane bag. Said, oh, isn't it a shame that my little squirrel's been working for its food? I'll feed my little squirrel the hulled pecans. She did. 5 weeks later, the squirrel got sick. She carried it to the veterinarian. The veterinarian said, I can't understand what in the world is happening. The teeth of this squirrel has grown longer than normal. What have you been feeding it? Shell pecans. I said, well, feed it pecans where it can bust the hulls. That's the way God made some of his creatures, was to work. She put the pecans over in the cage. Unfortunately, she had loved the little squirrel so much that she didn't want it to work, but she loved it to death. She deprived it of what it should have done, and the thing couldn't chew and would not eat, and the little squirrel died graveyard dead. The moral of this story is, if you're able-bodied, you go negotiate for you a job and go to work. You might have to drive up and down the street and find the yard that needs mowing. But people, America needs its citizens, if they're able, to go to work. You know, money was real short when me and Marcel Ledbetter was growing up, and we was wanting to get us enough of money to go see a Tarzan picture show. We caught a bunch of raccoons and sent the hide off to Sears and Roebuck, but the price dropped, and when we got our check, it was for a dime. That's all they brought. So we decided we'd take to the woods with our possum dogs and just sell possums for folks to eat. And we were in the Johnson Station community one night, out up north of the railroad where they had a lot of persimmon trees, and we was possum hunting. And about that time, I heard the big freight train coming. And Marcel broke and run with his lantern, put his red bandana around that light where it'd make it bright red, and he stood straddle of the railroad track and went to waving that lantern, flagging the train. Flagging that train. Whoa, he'd wave it. Man, 100 car banana train squeaked to a halt. The engineer and the fireman jumped off. Said, what kind of emergency do we have here? Marcel said, I wanted to see if y'all wanted to buy a possum. Man said, you idiot, you mean to tell me that you have done stopped 100 car banana train seeing if we wanted to buy a possum? You must be an idiot. But I like possum, and inasmuch as we have stopped, what do you want for him? Marcel said, we ain't caught him yet. I just want to see if you wanted one.